Good afternoon. Welcome to worship, their midweek worship today. This is the next to last of our Lenten midweek worship time. So it's good to have you all with us. Good to have you with us this afternoon. A couple of things that I want to let you know about. First of all, we have our meals, our grab-and-go meals available once again. Spaghetti and garlic toast today. So if you need lunch on your way out of worship today, be sure to stop into the fellowship hall and you can pick up a meal there on your way out of the building. One other great thing that we get to do today is sing. We have talked with the council last night and looked at ways that we can take some baby steps back into a little bit more normal congregational life. And we believe that we can do, one of the things that we can do fairly safely right now is return to some congregational singing. So we're keeping the masks on for that, but you are invited to sing along with the hymns today. And I know that one of the hymns is from our new hymnal supplement called All Creation Sings. So it's probably an unfamiliar song or hymn to you, but you are welcome to sing along with it nevertheless, or just listen to our song leader today and join in on the singing with the other hymns. We are also, we've gotten a little bit of good news as well with council last night. We have made a decision about help with our air ventilation and cleaning of the air in the sanctuary while leaving that outside air off, because I know that that's been an issue with our temperature control. We are going to be purchasing some portable mobile air cleaners that we can put into the sanctuary and use throughout the church, actually. We haven't ordered those yet, so they're not here yet, but those will be on the way very soon, and hopefully that will help us with the ventilation that we need, the quality of air that we need still during this time of COVID, but also making the worship experience a little bit more comfortable. So that will be coming soon. I invite you now, as we begin our service, to join in our call to worship. Let us worship God, who has done great things. We rejoice in our God, who made a way through the desert of this world. Let us worship God, who has caused streams of mercy to flow in the wasteland. We are the people God has formed through Christ. We worship him, and we rejoice. Let us worship God in spirit and in truth. We praise God for the grace that has saved us. We sing or listen to our hymn, Cast Out, O Christ. Please join together in our prayer. Gracious God, you sent Christ to heal the world and to gather those on the margins. Bring your healing power to us. May we extend your power and grace to those separated from their communities and those longing for a tangible sign of your love. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Our scripture for this afternoon comes from Mark chapter 5. They came to the other side of the sea, to the country of the Gerasenes. And when Jesus had stepped out of the boat, immediately a man out of the tombs with an unclean spirit met him. He lived among the tombs, and no one could restrain him anymore, even with a chain. For he had often been restrained with shackles and chains, but the chains he wrenched apart, and the shackles he broke in pieces, and no one had the strength to subdue him. Night and day among the tombs and on the mountains, he was always howling and bruising himself with stones. When he saw Jesus from a distance, he ran and bowed down before him, and he shouted at the top of his voice, "What have you to do with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? I adjure you, by God, do not torment me." For he had said to him, "Come out of the man, you unclean spirit." Then Jesus asked him, "What is your name?" He replied, "My name is Legion, for we are many." He begged him earnestly not to send them out of the country. Now there on the hillside, a great herd of swine was feeding, and the unclean spirits begged him, "Send us into the swine. Let us enter them." So he gave them permission. And the unclean spirits came out and entered the swine, and the herd, numbering about 2,000, rushed down the steep bank into the sea and were drowned in the sea. The swineherds ran off and told it in the city and in the country. Then people came to see what it was that had happened. They came to Jesus and saw the demoniac sitting there, but clothed and in his right mind, the very man who had the legion, and they were afraid. Those who had seen what had happened to the demoniac and to the swine reported it. Then they began to beg Jesus to leave their neighborhood. As he was getting into the boat, the man who had been possessed by demons begged him that he might be with him. But Jesus refused and said to him, "Go home to your friends and tell them how much the Lord has done for you and what mercy he has shown you." And he went away and began to proclaim in the Decapolis how much Jesus had done for him, and everyone was amazed. Well, Bible passages always kind of hit me in different ways at different times in my life, or when I'm experiencing, depending on the experiences that I'm having at that point in my life or the situations that I find myself in. And when I was reading this passage to prepare for worship today, and it's a passage I've read many, many times before, I was struck this time just by the overwhelming sadness of it, over this man's state, the sheer desperation of his life. He is a haunted man, possessed by demons who are causing him even to harm himself. And he's relegated to the places of the dead, wandering these desolate, isolated areas. He is alone. I doubt that the people who encountered this man would have been saddened by his state or by him, although maybe they were. I imagine they were more likely frightened and frustrated and even horrified, having their own desperation over what to do with him. He was completely out of control and out of his senses, and they just didn't know what to do. Now, this is a story that has a lot going on between the lines. It takes place in the area of the Gerasenes, it says to us. And this is actually important because the Gerasene area, region, is Gentile territory. And because it's Gentile territory, it's an unclean place for Jesus, a Jew, to go. It wasn't as if the people are clamoring to get him to come over. Nobody's invited him over into that area. Earlier in Mark, we have stories about these crowds that are following Jesus around. He can't get any time away. He can't be by himself for very long because the people are always gathering around him. But not here. This is a different place. And it's not that this is just a Gentile area, but everything about this place and the man Jesus encounters are unclean for a Jewish person. There's a herd of pigs that are grazing nearby, and pigs are an unclean animal for Jews to consume or even be around. And this man, it's called the demoniac, who comes running up to Jesus, has this unclean spirit in him. And he has been cast out of his home and his town, presumably cast out from his family and into this place of the dead. Now, Jewish Levitical law forbade contact with corpses. So it's a little spooky, but this man represents the uncleanest of the unclean, the most unclean you can get. And so this man has been sent away and pushed to the fringes, removed from his community to the place where people can mostly just avoid him, where he can be out of sight and out of mind as much as possible. He has lost family and friends and home and even his name. The only name we hear in reference to him is the name that the unclean spirit, the demon, gives, right? And it's legion. Legion is actually a term for a division of the Roman army, numbering about 6,000. And so it really means a many. It's a very great number. But it's a big problem for a Jewish man to walk into this situation, to head right into this unclean territory, into an unclean situation. But that is what Jesus does. This is an intentionally told story, so these details are very deliberate. And it tells us that Jesus is out for those who are unclean by society's standards. And Jesus is actually invading enemy territory, all to get to this one person, to steal that one away out of the grip of evil. So here's my first point. Jesus will go anywhere to save you. There is no place you can go where Jesus won't go in order to get to you. No barrier or line he won't cross to get to his children who find themselves in the most desperate of circumstances. This man, this demoniac, is a man living on the margins. Now, people on the margins are outsiders, those who don't seem to fit into a particular group, or maybe don't fit into any group at all. You can be a person on the margins at some point in your life and not at other points. Maybe you don't have any idea what it's like to exist on the margins, and maybe you know exactly what it's like. Jesus is out for those who are there on the margins, just like this man. One Bible scholar said Jesus refuses to leave the world as it is. He transgresses the boundaries. I like that phrase. Transgresses the boundaries and rescues those who seem to be beyond help. In healing the demoniac, calling out the unclean spirit tormenting him, Jesus brings wholeness to him. He restores this man. Now, when the people of the community next encounter the man, he is now clothed and in his right mind, not just cleaned up a little bit just to make him respectable, but healed, whole, snatched away from the realm of the dead and restored to life. Well, the people are not very happy with Jesus, though, because in the course of this healing, this exorcism, Jesus has caused someone's livelihood to go over the cliff and be plunged into the sea below and drown. But the man himself has been restored to his community. Jesus tells him, "Go home to your friends." And I wonder and imagine how amazing those words must have been to this man, how life-giving they must have sounded to him. Go home to your friends and tell them how much the Lord has done for you, what mercy he has shown you. Well, Jesus has not only given this man back his home and friends and community, Jesus has even turned him into a preacher. So my second point today, Jesus will go anywhere to save someone. Which sounds a lot like the first point I made, doesn't it? It is. But here's the thing. It's not just about me. It's about the other person. It's about the one who is pushed to the margins, not just the ones who get along fine in society, but Jesus has gone after them too. And in doing so, he brings those on the margins into a community with you and me. A community where we do not get to say, I don't need you, or you don't have a place here. For God has created us to be in community with one another, including those who are usually pushed aside. I want to end simply with words from the Apostle Paul, because I love how he describes this in 1 Corinthians. It's a beautiful description. So just listen to what Paul says. But as it is, God arranged the members in the body, each one of them, as he chose. If all were a single member, where would the body be? As it is, there are many members, yet one body. The eye cannot say to the hand, I have no need of you. Nor again, the head to the feet, I have no need of you. On the contrary, the members of the body that seem to be weaker are indispensable. Whereas our more respectable members, on the contrary, the members of the body that seem to be weaker are indispensable, and those members of the body that we think less honorable, we clothe with great honor, and our less respectable members are treated with greater respect, whereas our more respectable members do not need this. But God has so arranged the body, giving the greater honor to the inferior member, that there may be no dissension within the body, but the members may have the same care for one another. If one member suffers, all suffer with it. If one member is honored, all rejoice together with it. Thanks be to God. Amen. I invite you into a time of prayer. Accept, O Lord, our thanks and praise for all that you have done for us. We thank you for the splendor of the whole creation, for the beauty of this world, for the wonder of life and for the mystery of love. We thank you for the blessing of family and friends and for the loving care which surrounds us on every side. We thank you for setting us at tasks which demand our best efforts and for leading us to accomplishments that satisfy and delight us. We thank you also for those disappointments and failures that lead us to acknowledge our dependence on you alone. Above all, we thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ, for the truth of his word, for the giving of his life, for his steadfast obedience by which he overcame temptation, for his dying through which he overcame death, and for his rising to life again, in which we are raised to the life of your kingdom. Grant us the gift of your Spirit that we may know Christ and make him known, and through him at all times and in all places may give thanks to you in all things. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Now receive this benediction. The Creator who fashions us together with all things, the Christ who leads us into a new beloved community, the Spirit who holds us in the communion of saints, one God, bless you now and always. Amen. We listen or sing together our sending hymn, Jesus Keep Me Near the Cross, number 335.
Keep me near the cross. There's a precious fountain, free to all, a healing stream flows from Calvary's mountain. In the cross, be glory ever, till my ransomed soul shall find rest beyond the river. Near the cross, a trembling soul, love and mercy found me. And morning star sheds its beams around me. In the cross, be my glory ever, till my ransomed soul shall find rest beyond the river. Near the cross, O Lamb of God, bring its scenes before me. Help me walk from day to day with its shadow. In the cross, in
are sending words together. Let us go out with God's love to nurture us, with God's peace to comfort us, and with God's truth to guide us, remembering God promises to be with us always. Thanks be to God.